What did we learn so far? We introduced the concepts of a distortion function and a distorted expectation. So a distortion function was used to determine distorted tail probability. So we apply a function g on the tail probabilities f bar of a random variable x. In our application, we are in a risk management application. We want to think about the distorted expectations and the distorted probabilities as a stressed probability of our random variable x. So if we have a loss random variable, then the tail probabilities are the probability that the loss exceeds some threshold. So stressing these tail probabilities means that we want to increase these probabilities. How can we apply a distortion function such that the distorted tail probabilities are larger than the original tail probabilities? What we can do is we can use a concave distortion function. So with a concave distortion function, applying the function g on the tail probabilities will increase these probabilities. And then the distorted expectation of a loss random variable, it's the expected loss in the stressed scenario. On the other hand, if we have a income random variable, so if x denotes profits, income that you receive, then the tail probabilities, it's the probability that you receive more than a certain threshold. So stressing this probability means that we want to decrease this probability. So we want to decrease the likelihood of getting big incomes. How can we find a distortion function that applies a stress on an income random variable? In this case, we need a convex distortion function. Applying a convex distortion function on the tail probabilities will result in a decrease of the probabilities. And then the distorted expectation of our income random variable is the expected income in the stress scenario. So there you see that concave, convex distortion functions are important. Loss random variables, you combine it with concave distortion functions. Income random variable, you combine with convex distortion function. However, remember that sometimes, like in chapter 1, we want to start from a loss random variable x and then move to an income random variable minus x. So if x is a loss random variable, minus x is a income random variable. If we move from x to minus x, we move from losses to income. We also have to change distortion function. We want to move from a concave distortion function to a convex distortion function. If g is a concave distortion function, then the dual distortion function, which we denote by g bar, will be a convex distortion function. And this dual distortion function is defined with this formula. So the function g bar in q, it's 1 minus the distortion function applied in 1 minus q. So because you have the 1 minus q in the definition of a dual distortion function, it means that we start from the original distortion function, but we walk through this function from the right. We start in 1 and then we walk towards 0. That's the 1 minus q. And because we walk from the end to the beginning, it means that right continuous jumps for g become left continuous jumps for the dual distortion function. And concavity of the distortion function g becomes convexity of the dual distortion function. So what you can do yourself is first try to prove that g bar, the dual distortion function, is indeed a distortion function. So it means that we have to prove that the function g bar is non-decreasing, goes from 0, 1 to 0, 1, starts in 0 and in 1. And then you can prove this result, that right continuity becomes left continuity and left continuity becomes right continuity. And you can also prove that convexity becomes concavity and the other way around. But these proofs are relatively simple, so I leave that to you to prove. In this example, we have again a log normal random variable. The random variable x is a log normal random variable with mu sigma squared is the same log normal random variable as we had previously. The blue line here is the tail function of our log normal random variable. And the distortion function, gq, is the square root function. So it means that we have a concave distortion function. A concave distortion function means that we increase the tail probability. So the red line here is the distorted tail function. Because the distortion function is concave, the dual distortion function will be convex. So g bar will be convex. And applying a convex function on the tail function will result in a decrease of the tail probability. So the green line here is the dual distorted tail function. So if we now look at the random variable x, which is a log normal random variable, if this random variable x denotes the future losses, we have to use the red curve, the distortion function, to determine distorted expectation in the stress scenario. So stress then means increasing the tail probability, so it means picking the red curve. If x denotes income, it's the distribution, it's a log normal distribution, and big values of x means that you receive a lot of money, you have to stress your x random variable by using the dual distortion function, by decreasing the tail probabilities and using the green curve. So then you determine the dual distorted expectation, because then the dual distorted expectation corresponds with the expectation of the income under the stressed scenario. Note that in some cases, for example, when you think about trading, you have a risk X and we have two parties involved. And if X for me is a loss, it's again, it's an income for the other party. So we exchange the cash flow X. If X is positive, I have to pay the other party. If X is negative, the other party has to pay me. So then for me, X is a loss random variable, while for the other party, X is an income random variable. If I look at this claim, I want to determine the distorted expectation by using the red curve. While the other party is facing an income random variable, he will determine the risk by looking at the distorted expectation, but using the green curve. So he will determine the dual distorted expectation. So we look at the same random variable, but because it's a loss to me, I determine the distorted expectation. The other party will determine the dual distorted expectation. In this theorem, we relate the distorted expectation of a random variable with its dual distorted expectation. So for example, consider this result. So on the left-hand side, you have the distorted expectation of x, and we can prove that this is equal to minus the dual distorted expectation of minus x. So how can we understand this result? We will give a proof of this result later on. So assume that x is a loss random variable. Then we need a concave distortion function, because a concave distortion function means that you increase the tail probabilities, and it means that we can think about applying the distortion function as applying a stress on our loss random variable. Then the distorted expectation rho g of x is the expected loss, in the stressed scenario. So we stress using a concave distortion function. The distorted expectation is the expected loss in the stress scenario. Assume now that we transform our random variable x, our loss random variable, to an income random variable. So now we look at minus x. So minus x is now an income random variable. And to stress the income random variable, we need the dual distortion function, which is now a convex function. So we move from x to minus x, we move from the concave function g to the convex dual distortion function g bar. And then the dual distorted expectation rho g bar of minus x is the expected income in the stress scenario. What you see is we multiply by minus 1. We multiply the random variable x by minus 1 to go from a loss random variable to an income random variable. We change the distortion function g to to the dual distortion function G to go from a stress for loss random variables to a stress of income random variables. And then we see that if we combine these two, this is the distorted expected loss. What we have here is the distorted expected income. So we went from loss to income, then determined the distorted expected income, and then we have to move from this expected income back to a loss, and that's why we apply minus one here. Yeah? So we go from an income to a loss by again multiplying by minus one. But important to see is that this minus one here and this minus one here, they do not cancel. It's different with the expectation. The expectation of x is equal to minus the expectation of minus x. So now these two minus signs, they cancel. When we go from expectations to distorted expectations, this no longer holds. If you want that the minus signs, this one, if you want that they cancel, you have to change the distortion function from the distortion function g to the dual distortion function. Let me show you how you can prove these results. So we want to prove that the dual distorted expectation of x is equal to minus the distorted expectation of minus x. This is what we want to prove. So we start from the definition. So this distorted expectation is equal to the difference of two integrals. One minus, I use here the dual distortion function in the tail function of x, plus the other integral, the dual distortion function applied in the tail function of x. So this is just the definition. So note that the dual distortion function is defined as 1 minus the distortion function in 1 minus q, and the tail function, it's 1 minus the distribution function. It's 1 minus fx of x. So if you combine these, you find that the dual distortion function applied in the tail function, it's equal to 1 minus g, the distortion function in 1 minus the tail function. But 1 minus the tail function is a distribution function. So you find 1 minus the function, the distortion function applied in the CDF of x. So if we use this result, we find that we can rewrite the dual distortion function as minus, you have an integral from minus infinity to 0. 1 minus the dual distortion function becomes the original distortion function in the CDF of x. Plus, here you get that the dual distortion function is equal to 1 minus the distortion function g applied in the CDF. So now note that the CDF, it's the probability that the random variable x is smaller or equal than x. If you now multiply both sides by minus 1, we get that this is equal to the probability that minus x is bigger or equal than minus x. And this we call the function f tilde of minus x in minus x. So then you see that the function f tilde of minus x in some value x, it's the probability that minus x is bigger or equal than x, and the tail function of minus x is the probability that minus x is strictly bigger than x. Yeah? So the difference is here in the strict inequality and bigger or equal sign. So note that these two functions, first of all, they can be different. If you have probability mass in some point, x, then f bar, f tilde, take different values. Because in one case you include this probability mass, in the other case you do not include it. However, f bar and f tilde, these two functions, only differ in at most countable many points. And so it means that if we include the function f bar in an integral, you can change it to f tilde, because it's this the points where these functions are different as measure zero, so it doesn't affect your integration. So then you see that if you look at the integral from minus infinity to 0, 1, g applied in the distribution function, if you look at this integral, it's first of all the distribution function of x, it's given by this function here. So you find that this is equal to minus infinity 0 g applied in f tilde minus x dx. And because f tilde and f bar only differ on countably many points, this is equal to the function f bar minus x dx. So now you use a substitution that y is equal to minus x, then dy is equal to minus dx. Your boundaries of your integral change from minus infinity to 0 to plus infinity 0. So then your integral becomes an integral from 0 to plus infinity g applied in f bar minus x y dy. And in the same way, the integral from 0 to plus infinity 1 minus g fx of x dx is equal to, I can replace the f by the f tilde, and because f tilde and f bar differ only on countably many points, I can change the f tilde to f bar. So I get here 1 minus g f bar minus x dx. Then I use a substitution again, y is equal to minus x, and I find this is equal to integral from 0 to from minus infinity to 0, 1 minus g applied on the tail function of minus x in y dy. And then combining these results gives you that rho, the dual distortion function, it's equal to minus the integral from 0 to plus infinity g f bar minus x y dy plus an integral from minus infinity to 0, 1 minus g the tail function of minus x y dy, which is equal to minus the distortion function, where now I use distortion function g, so the distorted expectation of minus x. Yeah, so we use a distortion function g because you have the function g here. We use the minus x here because you have the minus x here and the minus x here. And this proves the result. The other result in the theorem of the previous slides, you prove it in a very similar way.